For the US women's soccer team, 1 month out from the World Cup. It's a chance for Jill Ellis and her players to fine-tune preparations here in the Midwest against an improving New Zealand. Welcome along to ESPN's coverage of US soccer, brought to you by Volkswagen. We're coming to you live from Busch Stadium in St. Louis, Missouri, the United States hosting New Zealand tonight. My name is Ian Darke, alongside Julie Foudy, who's won the World Cup at the Olympic Games as well. Now that, Julie, you've seen the selection that we've got from Jill Ellis for this World Cup, can they retain the trophy? Are they good enough?
They are good enough, and it's only 3 weeks away, I know, but they are definitely good enough. And two things they're going to have to think about to win it again. One, they got to stay healthy, and especially that front three. They are the best in the world when they're healthy and confident, which they are right now. And the second thing is they need more continuity and consistency with that back line, which they're trying to get in these last few games now that Kelly O'Hara is back. They do those two things, they definitely have the ability to win it all again.
It's a big, big crowd, by the way, here tonight, about 35,000 plus, we think. Here's the U.S. lineup for you tonight. Just a couple of changes from the team which beat South Africa 3-0 a few days ago. Lindsay Horan is back in the team. She's probably fit again. And Megan Rapinoe as well, dropping out of the side tonight. A couple of the players who played, Sam Mewis, who got two goals against South Africa, she's out of the side tonight, and so too is Kristen Press.
And the reason we have those two attacking center midfielders highlighted, because this is something they're going to see a lot in the World Cup. They're going to play teams that drop into a low block, that sit in a defensive bunker, and getting those two attacking center midfielders high is going to be critical. And this actually is the subject of my Continental Tire Analyst Corner, because when we saw Sam Mewis in the game against South Africa, they did just that. They were compact, they were in a low block. When she gets in that higher seam, and it doesn't just have to be Sam Mewis, of course, it could be any attacking center midfielder, you score goals and success happens, you break it down. That's something they're going to be looking to do tonight.
Yep, they want to have a bit of a wow factor. Now, Jill Ellis, the coach, of course, has already won the World Cup once 4 years ago. Can she do it again? She's talking now with Sebastian Salazar.
All right, coach, you're going to play probably in front of 35,000, maybe more tonight. How does that help you prepare for the upcoming World Cup?
Well, I think first of all, it's just the energy. You know, the players thrive off the energy. I think there's always challenging things in communicating when it's so loud. But I think overall, when we get over there, it's just going to be nice to know that we have fans back here and this kind of support. I think, you know, that's important when you go overseas, and hopefully we have big crowds there as well.
You're expected to have a lion's share of the possession in this match. Tactically, with the ball, what should we expect when you guys have it?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, we're going to be dynamic with the ball. I think it's, you know, we got to, especially I think they probably might come out in a back five. So I think just tempo on the ball, a little bit of patience at times when we get into the final third, and just being in really good positions to win the ball back. But I think overall, we've just got to have really good ball movement tonight and quality in the final third.
Thanks, coach. Appreciate the time.
Thank you.
So that's Jill Ellis, the coach of the U.S. What about tonight's opponents, New Zealand? Well, they're at the World Cup. They're ranked 19th in the world. One of their players says they've been through hell in the last year. The previous coach, very, very unpopular. 15 of the players threatened to resign. There was a government inquiry, believe it or not, in New Zealand. And in has come the former U.S. coach, Tom Samardi, to pour some calm waters. And that's an experienced team he's got out there tonight, about six of them with 100-plus caps.
And in particular, their captain and their leader, Abby Ersig. NWSL fans know her from the Carolina Courage, 2018 Defender of the Year. She is going to have her hands full tonight against that front three from the United States.
That's how the New Zealand team line up. Can they test the U.S., who are ranked number one in the world? They are there to be shot at this summer. How will they do tonight? Find out in just a moment.
The Pizzone from Pizza Hut. It's meaty, cheesy, melty, and you know it's big. The Pepperoni Pizzone is back and part of the $5 lineup. Two or more, just $5 each. No one out pizzas the Hut.
Wake up. There's a lot that needs to get done today. Small things, big things, too hard to do alone things. Day after day, you need to get it all done. And here to listen and help you through it all is Bank of America, with the expertise and know-how you need. to reach that blissful state of doneness. So let's get after it. What would you like the power to do?
Welcome back to ESPN's coverage of U.S. soccer, brought to you by Volkswagen. U.S. women playing New Zealand tonight in the send-off series. And what are the keys for the U.S. in this game? Well, let's look at the Volkswagen coach's notes.
Two keys, of course, and this is any coach going to a World Cup, but you look at confidence, building confidence, and second, you look at consistency, and those are the two things that Jill Ellis has been talking about. And when you get to that final 23 and you got 3 weeks, you want to be healthy coming out of these games, but you also want to be confident, and that's what they're going to try and get out of tonight.
The U.S. beaten only once this year, but it was against the hosts and one of the World Cup favorites, France, by 3-1. And the U.S. wearing the all-red outfit tonight, attacking the goal to your left to get us underway. And an early touch for Megan Rapinoe, who's just back from a calf injury, playing that one. And it's flicked on straight away, nearly Julie Ertz getting involved in there towards the back post. And New Zealand, this is going to be a very, very tough test for them. They've only ever once beaten the US, and that was way back in 1987. Were you playing then, Julie?
I was not on that roster, actually. I was playing. I think I had school. I missed that game. Otherwise, we would have won.
Of course, yeah. Big favorites here. Morgan laying the ball off to Rose Lavelle, and then Kelly O'Hara to play it wide to the tricky Tobin Heath. He scored in the final 4 years ago. That was the Carly Lloyd show, you might remember. She's on the bench these days. Heath to play it in there, and Rapinoe couldn't quite reach it as it bounced rather invitingly across the area.
And this is the tempo the U.S. didn't have in the first half against South Africa. And what they wanted to come out with was some pace. And you see it from Kelly O'Hara getting forward, Tobin Heath trying to find that back line, that back post. Pressing when they lose the ball. And that's not easy to do in 89 degree heat and humidity as it is still tonight, especially for 90 minutes.
New Zealand haven't done too badly lately, and that's a nasty one for Rosie White, who's that's her first involvement of her 100th cap. A very nasty blow to the face. So the referee, Karen Abt, will just have to stop the action for a moment here. The referees are instructed, once there's a head injury, the game has to stop. Player health. Ooh, my goodness me, that's horrible, with Crystal Dunn. You felt that from here, didn't you?
I know, and you just hate to see these when they happen.
And they've got to be careful because, of course, concussion is a now a very, very prevalent issue. No risks can be taken. And I'll be a bit surprised, I think, if Rosie White can continue after that. That looked a really, really shuddering collision.
And this is the thing as a player you think about, of course, and you don't want it to be front of mind when you get into these final send-off games. But it is still in your mind of, I can't be backing off tackles, is what you're thinking. And I can't go half into tackles because then you get yourself in trouble. But the last thing you want to do in one of these final games, of course, is get in a situation where you can't perform in the World Cup.
There's Tom Samani, the very likable and well-respected coach these days of New Zealand, formerly for 18 months of the U.S. It didn't quite work out for him in charge of the U.S. national team, but I think all his ex-players gave him a bit of a hug when they saw him. Mm. Good man from Scotland.
He's well-loved, Tommy.
Yeah. Well, Rosie White is going to continue. There's always this debate about, can they check successfully for concussion in the space of a couple of minutes and let players back on again? She's taken a knock to the teeth, I think.
Yeah, it looks like it's her jaw and mouth area.
Well, she's coming back on now, and to be fair, she sprints back on. Here's Riley. Los Angeles-born player who was very articulate at the press conference yesterday. Everything she was asked, she had a bright answer.
Well, you know where she went to school, Darke.
Oh.
The fine institution of Stanford, of course.
Well, that'll explain it all. That'll explain it all.
Played at the mighty Cardinal.
Here's Longo doing some tricky work. But to be careful not to trigger, she was just inside the area at that point. played in again. There is White. He could score here. Well, the US defence there allowed what was a very, very good scoring opportunity.
And this has been one of the areas where the U.S. has struggled, clearing balls, picking up second balls in the box. And this is the first time that they've had, actually, they've allowed 10 goals in 8 games this year, the U.S. has. They allowed 10 goals in all 20 games in 2018. And 4 multiple goal games, which you just don't see with the United States.
I mean, it's a good point, that, assessing the form. That's on the front foot this time, and it's gone out of play. Yeah, they've let in 3 against France, 2 against Japan, 2 against England, 3 against Australia, and those are all countries who are expected to be among the front runners when the World Cup gets underway in 3 weeks' time. Tobin Heath drifting one to the back post. Just a goal kick. Lindsay Horan wanted a bit more. She thought she might have been fouled there. Did she have a case? She's been carrying a bit of an injury lately, but fit enough to start tonight. Probably look after a few of these players who have got knocks, not give them the full 90 minutes here. Dispossessed there by Longo, one of the very experienced players. There are a lot of them around the New Zealand camp. Their big ambition is to win a World Cup match. They've never won a World Cup match so far. Drawn 3, lost 9 of World Cups. Fell for Lavelle. Her first touch wasn't quite good enough. Rose Lavelle, one of the players who's come through since the last World Cup, playmaker. Young player, exciting, lots of flair. Rapinoe looks to just roll one in. Given away by Katie Bowen. He's Julie Ertz. It was Julie Johnston at the last World Cup. Married to Zach these days, you'll know him. Ball ball from Crystal Dunn. She's been around the squad quite a long time, it seems, but will be going to her first World Cup as a left back these days. Here is Rose Lavelle with a sweet piece of action. The pass wasn't quite as good, and it was broken up by Rhea Percival, playing central midfield tonight. Aimed towards Gregorius. New Zealand qualified very easily. They beat Tonga 11-0, the Cook Islands 6-0, Fiji 10-0 and 8-0, New Caledonia 8-0.
And then Fiji again 8-0 in the final.
It wasn't the most testing of operations for them. It's much more serious for them in France, where they face the Netherlands and Canada, two good teams, and Cameroon, and they might have hopes of beating. But they've had the best chance of this game so far.
And that's the thing, the U.S. just has to get clean up, because good teams punish you in that situation. I'm watching.
Tobin Heath getting the better of Anna Green over there. Great crowd here. You think it might be a record for a standalone United States women's friendly. We'll confirm that maybe a little bit later. But it's a great tribute, I think, to the people of St. Louis that they've supported this match in such numbers, as they did when New Zealand came here before the last World Cup 4 years ago. US won that 4-0, by the way.
St. Louis is such a great soccer town. Always has been.
Oh, Megan Rapinoe was dreaming about a volley if that dropped in time, but Abby Essek did her job well. Tobin Heath, Rapinoe, flex up, end of that attack.
And in this first 8-9 minutes for the U.S., already doing a better job with tempo, which we talked about from the start, but also getting those attacking central midfielders into that seam. You saw the ball from Dunn into Rose Lavelle, where she mistouched it. But that's the ball you want, and into that attacking seam where Horan was as well, because when Rose Lavelle is facing goal and 30 yards out, she can make things happen. She's such a creative player.
Which is why she's
very important part of the side, a creative spark, a catalyst. Going to need that against the better teams to open them up. Roran. Back to Becky Sabrum. Nice crystal down into Roran again. Powerful midfield player. It's a lovely ball. Tobin Heath skips inside. Nice play. Can't get that last ball right so far.
Just a glimpse of what Tobin Heath can do, though, where she can just break apart defenses. One, two, three players come to her. That final pass, as you say, Ian, just a step off.
Well, you and I were talking with Megan Rapinoe, weren't we, last night? She was making that exact point. We've got to be more patient with the ball and make sure we engineer a very clear-cut opportunity, not force it too much too early. Let the opposition get it and counter.
She was talking about being too hasty to make that final pass.
It's a good point. Here is Megan Rapinoe. Ball inside, just cut out by Lavelle, trying to get Alex Morgan in. Very much the leading brand, it would seem, around the team. I noticed when her name was announced to the crowd here, they went wild. So she's got her name up in lights even before it starts, it seems. Kelly O'Hara couldn't get a foot around it to get the cross in. And carrying an ankle injury, hasn't she?
It's nice to have Kelly O'Hara back, though. She has been carrying an ankle injury. To have her back, she brings a bite and a craziness, as I think it was Rapinoe who told me, or it was Becky Sauerbrunn, actually. She brings a craziness and a bite to that back line that Becky says Sauerbrunn is so good to have.
Did she define what craziness was?
The best kind of crazy.
Is that not, I said, many, it's many, funny. Not many coaches' lexicon, that one.
I said, it's funny you say that. I said, craziness is an interesting word, because my reaction watching that South Africa game was, she brings, similar to what you see in Julie Ertz in midfield, she brings that intangible of just this feistiness that you want on your team.
Played by Hertz. Lavelle, full of bright ideas usually, Rose Lavelle. The US will expect to score quite a few goals, I would think, tonight, but you know, just recently New Zealand played their great rivals, Australia, who are one of the top teams in the world. They only lost by a couple of goals to nil. They've beaten Norway, who are quite well respected, too. So they're going the right way, New Zealand.
And you know, of course, with Tom Sermani as coach, they're going to be organized. They're going to play smart. I mean, whether you have the athleticism to beat the United States is another question.
Looking for fast breaks. Ali Riley, who plays for Chelsea in England. She hasn't been getting in the team too much lately, but a vital player. Now the break's on. Morgan trying to find Heath, but not a good ball in truth. Had to do better with that one. It's Abby Dahlkemper, another of those who's come into the squad since 4 years ago, and they, well, handsome victory in 2015. Crystal Dunn. It's a careless one, truthfully. You can't afford to give the ball away that cheaply, can you, Julie?
Well, you look at that grass behind the referee right there. That's the infield. It was dirt here for the St. Louis Cardinals.
Yeah.
And you could see that seam. Not to make excuses, but there's the foul there, but it's a hard surface with those seams. They've laid that turf down. It's soft.
Yeah. Great stadium, isn't it? Home of the Cardinals, as you were saying. looks fantastic, and it's nice and full as well. Get a feeling that the American public get quite switched on by the Women's World Cup and what it might bring. Three World Cups have been won by the US and four Olympic gold medals as well. ESPN's coverage brought to you by Volkswagen, presenting partner of US Soccer. And in part by KFC's new Cinnabon dessert biscuits, available for a limited time only at KFC. Away by Erseg, who's vital central defender for New Zealand. He's resigned from the squad twice, and there's a lot of bad feeling about the previous coach Andreas Herath, and the whole thing looked like falling apart for New Zealand until he was replaced after a government inquiry. I think the CEO of New Zealand the Soccer Federation got fired as well,
and the chairman
of that. Yeah. So anyway, I think Tom Samani poured a few cups of tea and has a few chats with the players, and they're all back on board, and here they are.
And they said he's been our, Ali Riley said yesterday, he's been our saving grace.
Yeah.
Less touches on the ball! One, two touches!
And they literally said 15 of us are going to walk away, so. And this is Abby Ersic's second time coming back from retiring from the national team. The first time was because she was unhappy with the Federation's support of the program in protest.
Darke doing well, getting it back to Lisa Nayer, the goalkeeper who's taken over these days from Hope Solo. In fact, it's already her 62nd cap here. Looking through the field, I think, you know, you could give a chance, a big chance, to five or six teams, but there are a few after that as well who are, it's no formality to beat them.
No, and that's the difference. This is the first time in a World Cup where I've gone in and said, ah, I can count on more than one hand potential winners.
Yeah, France, England, Germany, Australia, Japan, Canada are useful. Sweden, who are in the US's group, are useful, as the US found out at the last Olympics.
Netherlands, although I don't know if they have enough.
Yeah, European champions. Around to play that inside. England defending pretty well in the main, though, so far. That's one thing Tom Samani's drummed into them, to be organized at the back with Abby Ersag in charge of it all.
And this is a good look with that wide shot of how they're setting up offensively. We'll get to that next time they get the ball, but right now they're pressing their three attacking center midfielders high for New Zealand, keeping Gregorius up high as well, so that it's forcing the U.S. to stay home a little bit more, or at least trying to force them.
It's Crystal Dunn. It's going to be too long. Of course, it's not just about Jill Ellis. There's a whole team getting the players ready for this World Cup, and Sebastian Salazar down at pitch side has more for us on that.
Yeah, guys, in our pregame interview, we heard Jill Ellis talk about tempo. Well, from what I'm hearing from the sideline right now, I don't think they're too happy with the tempo. I keep hearing quicker, quicker, one-two touch from the U.S. bench. They've also asked Lindsay Horan to play a little bit higher in midfield, and Kelly O'Hara to get up this right flank. Ali Riley being a very aggressive for New Zealand, and acres of space on this right flank for O'Hara if she wants it.
Thanks, Seb. Here's Gregorius, who scored 8 goals in the qualifying campaign. Tiny striker, but a lively one. Sarah Gregorius. Rounder, they want to play higher, having to do some defending in this 4-3-3 formation that the US use. I wonder whether they might have to just tweak that a little bit when they play some of the bigger teams.
maybe midfield players.
They could go too deep with one next to Ertz. But I think the bigger challenge for them is just that, what Sebastian was pointing out, is trying to get those attacking center midfielders higher, because your tendency as a player, when someone's sitting in a lower blocker, you have time, is you go seek the ball and you go back. And you seek the ball because that's away from pressure when they're all sitting in like that. But they've got to get higher and into those seams that pass on those players.
Hannah Green, the left back, comes over to the right-hand side to take the corner. I think she said, it's not really enough room for me to do that. I think she might have wanted to play a long one, but there wasn't room for her to run up and take it. I really think that's what she was saying. I don't think they could move any of the advertising hoardings at that moment, though. I think she's got a point, by the way.
I have a left foot instead of a right one, and I can't take it from this side. There is no space.
Yeah, so they're not used to having soccer matches in here. You can tell. It's Julie Ertz. Happy Dahl, Kemper. Gotta use some invention here to try to open up this defence. New Zealand are playing it right. They know what they are. They're defending, and if they can counter and get out, they will. I think so far they've done that quite well. Counts again, sitting deepest of the midfield players. Rapino goes for the return ball. It was nice up to that point, but then Michaela Moore was able to get across, just not quite the right weight on that ball. Alex Morgan struggling to get in the game a bit, isn't she?
And you heard Jill Ellis in the opening interview with Sebastian Salazar. What was one of her keys? Clean in that final third, connecting in that final third.
O'Hara's cross had the defense wondering for a moment. Rapinoe, good deep ball. O'Hara kept it alive. But Alex Morgan unable to keep that down. 101 goals she has now for the US, Alex Morgan.
Rapinoe always in the action. When she came in second half against South Africa, I thought her and Carly Lloyd, such a boost for the team. Led the team in assists in 2018, Megan Rapinoe as well.
Of course, she was the one who made that great cross for Abby Wambach back in 2011. That, well, never to be forgotten game against Brazil when, well, the US came back from the dead, really. Down to 10 players. Won it on a penalty shootout in the end after equalizing in the 122nd minute.
Mm. What a ball that was, huh?
It was an evening a bit like tonight. Sultry, wasn't it? As it is here in St. Louis tonight. Very pleasant, everybody in shirt sleeves, including Tobin Heath here. Here's O'Hara. Big cross on the game. The defending is pretty good from New Zealand. The Ferns, as they're known. Because the biggest sport by far in New Zealand is rugby union. And they will be favourites to win the Rugby Union World Cup later this year in Japan. It is a religion there.
Oh, yeah. Women's rugby team there is very good as well.
Yeah. And they quite like their cricket as well. Beautiful countries where they filmed Lord of the Rings, of course. New Zealand. South Island especially. So if you ever get the chance. Sounding like the New Zealand tourist board here.
I was just going to say. Ian will book your flights.
Yeah, it's all true.
Your hotel, it's all one package.
And why not? Here's Abby Dahlkemper. Oh, I've seen plenty of the ball. She's probably not going to play the full 90 minutes. Rapinoe's just found a nice little pocket of space there and took a knock to the ankle for trouble. Just limping away. Following the end of our game here, it's MLS on ESPN2 tonight. Carlos Vela and the LAFC hosting FC Dallas from the Bank of California Stadium in Los Angeles. Should be a good game. Streaming live on the ESPN app as well. Join John Champion and Taylor Twellman for that.
Great game. How about the LAFC? Doing well.
Yep. Riley's ball forward. Just skewed off the outside of her boot, really. In the United States for Gold Pride and Western New York Flash, remember them?
Won two championships with them.
Yeah. And Captain Stamford. Ring any bells?
Played alongside Kelly O'Hara at Stamford.
Playing for New Zealand, she does talk with an American accent. More to lay wide. It's a good ball. Very well. It's picked out Hannah Green. I think Tom Samani will be very pleased, really, with the way his New Zealand side are coping here. Katie Duncan in the center of midfield there.
And this is exactly what they want to do. Slow the game down.
Give the goalkeeper a look at the ball. He can check the maker's name.
Kill the tempo.
Yeah.
Make them chase. No one wants to be chasing in this 90-degree humidity.
Well, I think it's good that the US here, just building up to the World Cup, have to think about this a little bit, because probably no game is going to be a formality out there. Rapina, that's a good ball. Lindsay Hurren, who plays for Portland. Nice ball she finds as well. Crystal Dunn. Lovely little skill and a beautiful touch by Morgan, and well saved indeed by the goalkeeper Erin Naylor.
Great reaction save by Naylor there. And that's the first time we've seen him in that final third have some success. Good movement, good ball movement before that. And Crystal Dunn with that final move to get in line. And Morgan at that near post, knowing I just need to get a touch on this one.
Tobin Heath has a bit of an opportunity here. Couldn't quite get that ball away from Katie Duncan. That was a clever effort by Alex Morgan. Deft. O'Hara pushing high. Juliet's just let the ball slip away, but Megan Rapinoe's got it now. Morgan tries to line up her, and quick feet from her. Rapinoe. Away by Rosie White. Over that head injury she received early on in the game.
Player New Zealand's missing gives them a little bite up top as Hannah Wilkinson, of course. Player U.S. fans may remember her from her time at Tennessee, SEC star, and seemed to always be scoring on the United States when they play New Zealand.
Crystal Dunn takes the deflection. Yeah, Hannah Wilkinson, who you mentioned, she scored the last four times New Zealand have scored against the U.S. She's coming back from a cruciate injury. Most coaches from most countries would say not going to pick her,
right,
because she's only been back training full time for a week. But Tom Samani here, he took the decision. She's so good that we'll try to get her fit bit by bit. I don't think we'll see her tonight, but we might see her soon. We'll try to give her a few minutes. Like, New Zealand are going off to play against England and Wales shortly, and Mexico behind closed doors before that. Play from Rapinoe. It's the byline, looks to pick the right cross in there. LeBow was arriving. That was a good move, just starting to create a little more.
Seeing it all happen from individual effort. Crystal Dunn before on the left side, this time Rapinoe. Need more players in that box, though, making runs. Way too static for the United States.
And they've just struggled to get that final ball right so far. That was a better one. Inside. Crystal Dunner was married in the last few months. Yes, very important player, an automatic pick in this team when fit. But still no breakthrough for the US. Surprisingly, maybe. I think the big crowd turning up here tonight thought they might see a bit of a goal spree. Up. It's been a little bit frustrating for the US. Incidentally, the latest 30 for 30 podcast tells the backstory of the 99ers.
Talk about frustrating. Yes. Here it is. Listen.
The 99 Women's World Cup team captured America's hearts, went on to do even greater things. You can listen to all the episodes at 30for30podcast.com/pass. They're also available on Apple Podcasts and Spotify.
Well, the frustrating part is that podcast is about us launching the first WSA and then not surviving. Great podcast, by the way, even though it did bring back some heartbreak and heartburn.
And we'll show you a little segment of that, by the way, at halftime, just to whet the appetite. New Zealand have free kick after the good work there by Gregorius. She's going to be an important player for New Zealand if they're going to get anything at the World Cup.
Without Hannah Wilkinson, if she can't get a lot of minutes, Gregorius has scored in over a third of the games she's played.
Yeah.
99 caps.
Could New Zealand come up with a shock goal here? Abby Essex come forward from the back, and we're trying to get on the end of this, but it's too near to Alyssa Naya. Wasn't the greatest ball in. Riley with the important header, hooked forward, and here's Tobin Heath. They wanted an offside at the moment. Heath made contact with the ball, that flag went up, and that's what they're told to do, the linesman.
Well done by Nayer here, because how many times have we seen this punched out and it's punched back centrally and short or down? She at least gets enough on it to clear those lines out. And that's going to be the challenging thing for U.S. goalkeepers in this World Cup, for Nayer. You're not seeing a lot of play. You're not seeing a lot of the game. And then all of a sudden you got to make a big save.
Yeah. Concentration very, very important in that position. Hard for Anna Green.
This is why. Ooh. Pretty easy call, that one.
Leaving Rose Lavelle.
Not sure what she was arguing there.
She definitely wanted to leave something on her there, no question about it.
I mean, New Zealand must be thrilled with this 32 minutes in. We were talking to Tom Sermani last night, and some of the players didn't get in from New Zealand until Monday night.
Yeah.
You think about that, to play in this heat. You could see the flushed face of Anna Green.
You know, the jet lag might kick in a little bit later on.
To go 90.
Yep. I think at this point, Jill Ellis might be a little worried about how little the US have actually created in terms of clear-cut opportunities. Just the one, really.
And it's disjointed. Everyone feels so far apart. Long passes, disjointed final third.
And the passing a little bit imprecise in the final third. To be fair to the players, this is a difficult time for them, isn't it? It's kind of like a phony war just before the World Cup. Everybody's a little bit mindful of maybe not picking up an injury. They all know they've made the squad, players of both teams. Morgan with a good bit of hold-up play there. Rapinoe, lovely ball, and that will be the opening goal, scored by Tobin Heath for the US. That was a peach of a pass from Rapinoe to set it up.
Megan Rapinoe having the awareness, and literally you had to thread that needle, seeing on the back post Tobin Heath poaching with the pace to get it there with her left foot. What a ball that is. And Heath just waiting, knowing it's coming from Rapinoe, getting in position. But all of that is Megan Rapinoe.
Great credit to Tobin Heath for reading that and making that run as the wide right player towards that back post. And to be honest, the New Zealand defenders switched off. Heath was thinking quicker than her. That's why she got there. That's why she scored her 29th goal for her country.
But the pace of that ball, so key. You got to whip that ball in.
Been among the goals a little bit this year, scored against England and Brazil and Australia this year, and now against New Zealand as well. Very experienced operator, Tobin Heath, who's coming up to 150 caps. In fact, the one after this will be the 150th. She's one of those players that can give the US that little bit of an X factor that you need, provide something different. Here's O'Hara taking on Riley. Riley often plays at left back, but is being deployed a little bit further forward tonight. If that goal gets the US to engage maybe slightly higher gear. Not for the moment, because the flag's up on that far side. US resuming normal service a little. Juliet's with the header forward. Morgan with the layoff towards Heath again. That's quite a cynical foul, actually. She's just hacked her down, hasn't she?
Easier than chasing.
Rosie White. White's ball again towards Longo. Not accurate enough. It's very important for New Zealand that they do have periods where they can keep the ball and maybe just give their defence a breather. Otherwise, it can be a long old night out there. Don't forget to listen to the Laughter Permitted with Julie Foudy podcast. That's what it says here. New episodes weekly. Listen on the ESP app or Apple Podcasts.
Yeah, we talk to rad women, Ian. You should listen. Mia Hamm is on there. Abby Wambach. Not just soccer players, though. Simone Biles.
Does that work with your husband as well, the laughter permitted?
He does laugh. He listens.
Sounds good anyway. Well, I'll have to give it a listen now.
Yes, you should.
They told me to.
You should. I can't believe you have it already.
Yeah, well, what would I be without it in future?
You have a long flight home. You can listen to it all 10
The whole
episodes.
Series, in fact. That's with the head up. So I like the way there, she's just got her head up and directed the traffic ahead of her. All starts on June the 11th for the US team. The tournament itself starts a bit before that on the 7th with France, the host, playing South Korea on that day. 24 nations involved in it. 24 nations is double the number who competed in the first two editions in 1991 and 95. It's a growing game, growing interest. I think it'll be big this summer.
I agree. I think it's going to be very big. Most competitive World Cup we've ever seen by far.
That's nice from WS. She's starting to play a bit better. Lindsay Horan with a good-looking cross in and a second goal. Beautifully delivered. Rose Lavelle, the young lady from Cincinnati, with a lovely finish. Two very good goals for the United States women's team here.
Two very good goals and two very good balls in. This is the movement of Lindsay Horan. A run you don't want to track as a defender. They don't. She's wide open. And boy, Rose Lavelle made that look easy. Coming back a little bit on her left foot to keep that down and put it in the back of the net. That is a great finish by the other attacking central midfielder.
Both goals coming down the left side. Good deliveries. That was not an easy finish for Rose Lavelle, who's from Cincinnati, like Doris Day, who we lost the other day very sadly. Well, maybe a case of que sera, sera for Rose Lavelle this summer. Seventh goal of her international career. There will be more for certain. Moore's done well. Quite composed back there. His green has already been booked in the game. O'Hara there at right back. It's an interesting selection. Was Ali Krieger, who's on the bench tonight. Recalled after a couple of years, just lately, for her dependability. She's worked her way back into contention, and she's won the nod in the squad. We might see her later on here.
That would be her 100th cap if we do see her later on. Big moment for Ali Krieger, and boy, that woman, talk about someone she hadn't seen or heard from the national team for 2 years, and she just never gave up hope that she could get back in there. And persevered, and she's getting a chance, going to her third World Cup.
Having said that, you do feel sorry, because it's a heartbreaker, isn't it, for those players who just missed out, were considered and not picked. Players like Casey Short, Lynn Williams, Sophia Huerta, Taylor Smith, McCall Zaboni, Mandy Sullivan, Emily Fox, Jane Campbell. Tough, very tough.
It is always hard. There's Ali Krieger there.
But you can only pick 23. You're just giving the ball away. Just starting to look a little more tired now.
Fatigue is starting to set in.
Yeah. This is where they've got to be careful. Lavelle. O'Hara. It looks plenty fit enough to me after her recent problems.
Her first game back against South Africa on Sunday. I thought she looked sharp as well.
Played into Juliet. Shot was blocked. But they can't get out at the moment. New Zealand just rocked by those two goals in quick succession. Just when they thought they were doing well. Kevin Heath to play that one in. Ersek to get it away. But only as far as Crystal Dunn, who probably picked the wrong ball.
And here's the challenge now for New Zealand as well, as that play was two outside backs getting forward. Kelly O'Hara on the right, Crystal Dunn on the left. And when you have both of them going and locking in plays too, that second ball that comes out, they're cleaning up right away. You just can't get out of your back third if you're New Zealand.
Lavelle again. Just a bit too long for Alex Morgan. He was hoping for a header. White battles away. Probably need half time, I'd say, New Zealand here, because the US have just turned up the volume a bit, haven't they? Despite the rest of the world getting a lot better at women's soccer, I'm just going to say, Julie, despite the rest of the world getting better, I still think any team that beats the US will probably win the competition.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing with the US, is they don't fatigue either.
Morgan. By the way, coming up at halftime, we'll show you some of the best moments from that 99ers reunited with Julie Foudy and her teammates. And we'll be hearing from John Champion and Taylor Twelman previewing tonight's LAFC, the FC Dallas match, which follows us. So don't go away once this one has finished. There's some good action on the West Coast. Minutes of added time at the end of the half. New Zealand did have a big early chance for Rosie White. US struggled for a while, but they're not struggling at the moment. Here's Lavelle again, giving real drive to the midfield. It's a miscue by Riley. It nearly fell for Morgan to turn it in. That would have been a calamity for the football Ferns defence.
Every time New Zealand wins the ball back, they lose it, and then they're chasing, and the fatigue certainly setting in for them. And the U.S. doing a very good job of getting Rose Lavelle forward, Lindsay Horan forward, those outside backs forward in these last 10.
This stage the US super fit and hopefully getting super sharp ahead of the tournament itself. That is half time. I think New Zealand needed that break as well, because the US really got on top. Rose Lavelle getting a wonderful goal after Tobin Heath had put the US ahead. More coming up in just a moment. That's the story at half time. Welcome back to ESPN's coverage of US soccer, brought to you by Volkswagen. Ian Darke and Julie Foudy with you from the Busch Stadium in St. Louis, Missouri. United States 2-0 against New Zealand at halftime. And if you're a little bit late joining us tonight, here are the two goals again coming up. They were both good ones as well. I had to wait a while for them, Julie.
It took till the 35th minute, but there is Megan Rapinoe with the beauty of a ball. Watch Tobin Heath on that backside, gets around her defender. That's Anna Green, and the same thing on this play. 41st minute, Rose Lavelle getting by Anna Green on the left side, and what a finish that is to keep it down low. And again, a second great ball in, this time from Lindsay Horan.
And there's going to be a substitution made at halftime. There is Samantha Mewis, who's going to replace Lindsay Horan. We were kind of told that Lindsay Horan would not play the full 90 minutes tonight after her recent injuries, so don't read too much into that. And obviously Sam Mewis is in a bit of form at the moment.
three goals, two in the last game against South Africa. She's looked very good.
You get the feeling that the starting lineup is kind of set in the coach's mind for certainly the opening World Cup game, but the players who are not in that starting lineup will be thinking they might just be able to do something here to change her mind. It's up to them, isn't it, to do that in training, and if they do get a chance like Lewis is here in the game.
I could tell you another player on that bench who's thinking that way as well. Carly Lloyd, with the
yes.
way she's been playing. She's thinking, I want some minutes.
Oh, she had such a sensational World Cup 4 years ago, including that hat-trick in the final. Named Women's Player of the Year. Having to be a kind of, she hopes, super sub these days. Here's Megan Rapinoe. She was clever again there. She was looking for that free kick and she's got it. It's taken very, very quickly. Lewis involved. Quick thinking. You'd like to see that.
Lewis getting a goal off a quick restart against South Africa. And those are the little things you have to pay attention to when the game is trying to be slowed down by your opponent.
Yeah.
You have to manufacture that energy and that tempo.
I mean, somewhat quick thinking can do in that Liverpool-Barcelona game. Trent Alexander-Arnold's quick thinking corner. Lewis involved straight away. She's gone past three players. And the flag's out for offside here. As Lavelle cuts it back. It's quite a start to the game, this by Lewis.
You talked earlier, Ian, about against some of the better teams, the United States maybe switching up that formation a little bit, not necessarily the 4-3-3, but putting there's Carly Lloyd warming up on the sideline, putting two holding midfielders rather than what they have been playing with Ertz holding and two attacking central midfielders. And this is more of that situation, although you won't see Sam Lewis holding, obviously, as much against a team like New Zealand, but she would be the one you would sit more with Ertz.
Crystal Dunn. That's wearing a red tonight, trying to get Alex Morgan in behind. Alex Morgan, who scored in the 2011 final against Japan. Ooh, just stretching out a leg to concede the corner there, Moore. Taken quickly. No rest by Ertz. She missed her header there in the middle. Ersek. She headed thin air. It nearly led to a chance.
You can turn.
Parrot to knock it long. They're looking for a little flick on to Megan Rapinoe. Not quite.
A lot of success on that right-hand side of the U.S. team. Both goals coming from that right side. Again, fatigue a factor. Anna Green on both those plays. Slow to recover. Heath gets in behind her. Rose Lavelle as well. Be interesting if the U.S. can capitalize on that right side again this half.
Lewis. Tobin Heath with the layoff. Quite a lot of depth in the US squad, and I think that was part of Jill Ellis' thinking. What if one of my regular starters can't make it, is injured, suspended, or something like that at the World Cup? Can I rely on whoever is going to come in to fill that little gap?
I think that's why you see some of those decisions for those last players. Ali Krieger with experience, Morgan Bryan with experience. Even though they haven't had a ton of time with the team as of late. I was actually surprised though with the Morgan Bryan one because she had been fighting through some injuries. An excellent player, but
she's only played once this year, hasn't she? And that was against France in the first game of the year.
has been struggling to get back from those injuries, find her rhythm, find her confidence. I thought that's a slot you say, okay, maybe I give this to a younger kid who I can bleed in with some experience here. Or to a player that brings something situationally, tactically.
Keith to control. Morgan waiting in the middle. The goalkeeper just come a little off her line. He might have been embarrassed by that, but I don't think it was quite the cross Tobin Heath had in mind. Or maybe it was. Could have sneaked in, I guess. Maybe she was just saw a little gap. She's clever enough to do things like that, that's for certain. Picking up after a slow start here, the US. Great support, great buzz, great interest around the team, particularly at this time. The US have lost one of their last 36 matches. The defeat against France, the team that beat them before that, to go back to a tournament of nations a year or so back against Australia, is Mewis with Rapinoe pulling into space, gets the ball, that's where she wanted it, invited to shoot into the side netting. She's very disappointed, I think, in herself there, Megan Rapinoe. You can tell.
And boy, Heath, after she played that ball, and look at Heath on that back post wanting to get it again. Play me on that back post. She took off like a rocket.
Megan Rapinoe did get a couple against Australia at the last World Cup.
But those are the moments where, against the better teams again, you got to get something on frame. You got to get something on net with a situation like that. Put it 3-0 and close this game out, right? You can rest players then if you're in a World Cup situation. You've got 7 games you have to win over the course of a month to win a Women's World Cup.
You've got to be ruthless. And of course, the way the draws worked out, it could be that the US have to play France as early as the quarterfinals. I wonder if they might just jockey for position.
If, Sweden game?
If the chance arose, we'll keep abreast of that one. It's Rapinoe to lay it inside. Dunn accelerates through the gap, using that speed she has as a former striker. Let's have a quick look at how it is for the US. They start on the 11th against Thailand, 16th Chile. And then Sweden is the final game in the group. Could be that both Sweden and the US have maximum points going into that last game.
Highly probable.
Probable, yeah.
Right. So what do you do in that game, Ian Darke?
It's not a decision I have to take. Don't worry about that.
If you're coaching the team, if it's France, you got to meet in the quarterfinals. If you win Group F and France wins their Group A, the US and France, assuming they win their round of 16th, game, which maybe is not an assumption we should make, but let's do that for the purposes of this great debate.
Yes. Well, you might be pragmatic, might you, in the coach, and just say, well, if we've got to play them, let's play them later in the final. It's a dangerous game to play.
Exactly. And it's not one that the United States mentality allows
You saw it with Belgium and England at the World Cup, didn't you? The final game in that group, where it kind of was like a reserve game.
Yeah, I can't imagine as a player going, yeah, you know, it'd be okay if we tied this game or lost this game. I mean, that is not in our vocabulary as a player.
Yeah, but then you might be sitting on the plane four nights later on your way home thinking, right. Well, maybe we should have just taken a sort of slightly cuter view of it.
It certainly gives you a chance to rest some legs if you need it, or get some injured players healthy.
Back to Becky Sauerbrunn, who's playing in her hometown, of course, tonight. special experience for her. I don't think she was ever going to get left out, but the coach was always going to pick her. There was a mistake there, which has allowed Rapinoe in. As well, one back by Rhea Percival, and there still could be something for the USA. Alex Morgan nearly managing to cash in. Good save in the end. Done. Cut back. Good defending by Ersek. Rapinoe. And behind. It seemed the US would have to get a third there at some point in that attack, but they didn't.
And there's the face that shows everything on Meg Rapinoe. I think actually that's the wrong decision. She had Crystal Dunn making that overlap. I think she thought the defense was going to shift with Dunn, and I'm going to then take it inside. I think the better decision would have been to play Dunn in, because she was in. And then the shot, I think, was ambitious as well by Rapinoe. You could see it on her face.
The U.S. have got a left back at this World Cup who's actually scored 5 goals in one game for the U.S. against Puerto Rico in 2016 when she played further forward. Here she is right on cue on the ball now to Sam Lewis. And Rapinoe there, just a bit of a loss of concentration. ESPN coverage brought to you by Volkswagen, presenting partner of U.S. Soccer. Really splendid scene here at the home of the Cardinals. Of course, this town was in the news last night with that game, the hockey playoff between the Blues and the Sharks, and they're still moaning about that, the local fans. Well, controversial stuff.
I'm happy we...
They don't have VAR, you see.
Yeah, I'm just happy we made it home after Brandy Chastain sitting there with her. She's a San Jose resident, of course, yelling "Go Sharks!" every time someone that had a Blues jersey walked by.
Well, she was a risk to be around, really, in this city.
I was like, "What are you doing?" No, I didn't. I just giggled.
Anyway, the goal stands, despite the hand. Nobody's called it the hand of anything just yet. Here's Juliet for the US. Becky Sauerbrunn, much leader of the pack. Surprising to hear, she said she used to have confidence problems when she first got into the team. Wondering if she really was good enough. I think she might just have proved that by now. One of the best defenders in the world over recent years. Tobin Heath, one of the best wingers. Might get another chance with the cross, but New Zealand pretty much in survival mode just at the moment. They started off looking for counters, but they can't get out, really. Six substitutions allowed. I'm a bit surprised Tom Samani hasn't used a couple just to freshen it up a little. That's nice movement, but offside against Rose Lavelle. But that was an enjoyable, pleasing passing bout.
New Zealand having a world of trouble when Lavelle, or in this half, Lewis, those attacking center mids, making that run out of midfield.
Carly Lloyd is going to come on the right there. She's going to replace Katie Duncan. That's the New Zealand change anyway. Two changes coming up. We are going to see Ali Krieger. There she is, number 11. On her way to a World Cup she thought would never happen for her. Just kept plugging away with her club form. Off comes Megan Rapinoe. That's just, I think, for safety's sake after her recent calf injury, not to do 90 minutes. Had a really good game. And here's Carly Lloyd. You can hear what the crowd think of her.
Ali Krieger coming in for her 100th international game.
Here's more on Ali Krieger now from Sebastian Salazar.
You know, I had a chance to talk to Ali yesterday about her time outside the national team. She used the word confused. During the time, though, she said she watched every game and she saw that the outside back spots were not being locked up. So she said she, you know, still saw a path. She also credits her Orlando Pride teammate, former U.S. international. I'll leave it for you guys.
Kevin Heath, that is a goal straight away. Carly Lloyd with her first touch shows she still has the Midas touch. How about that? That's four in the last three games for her.
Co-leads the team as well with those four goals alongside Tobin Heath. And this is a player that you can just tell. When people doubt Carly Lloyd rises to the occasion. Do not tell her at 36, turning 37 at this World Cup, that she still can't do it. FIFA World Player of the Year in 2015 and 16. And the thing you love about her is she's such a fighter. She came into that South Africa game, we were talking about it earlier, and gave them such a lift as well. And you know she relishes the opportunity.
Cut back and hacked away by New Zealand, who are living on their nerve ends a little back there now. Well, what a start. That was her 109th goal for her country. And most of them, about two-thirds of them, have come since she turned 30.
It's phenomenal what she's done in her 30s.
Sam Lewis, there's a lot of space starting to appear here as a flagging New Zealand side trying to stay as best they can with their more illustrious opponents. Kemper's done well. Just a sour run. Of course, they've got the youngest player in the squad, Tiana Davidson, only 20, hoping for a chance back there as well. I think she wouldn't let the US down should she have to play. Total control and dominance from the United States team now.
And the thing about Carla, you get, if you bring her in, and if this is going to be the rhythm for the United States in those 30 minutes, is she can close out games. When they're up 2-0, they were struggling to get that third goal. Carly comes in, first touch, boom. Closed out the game, although it was in the very end against South Africa, but did the same thing. She just scores big goals in big moments, and you know you're going to get that from her.
And that 109 goals, there it is. That makes her the highest scoring active player for the United States at the moment. Of course, Abby Wambach, now retired, leads the scoring charts with, I think it's 184 off the top of my head. Still fit, still fired up, Carly Lloyd. Watching the ESPN's coverage of US soccer, brought to you by Volkswagen, live from the Busch Stadium in St. Louis, Missouri. USA against New Zealand here. CN Darke alongside Julie Foudy with, as you've been hearing, Sebastian Salazar giving us reports from the field. By Michaela Moore. I think New Zealand probably reaching out for respectability in this game. Now, the one thing you don't want just ahead of a World Cup is to take a real horrible trouncing, which would damage morale a little. Is Lavelle, Heath, this time it's a flying header. Yes, right into the thick of the action, Carly Lloyd. New Zealand just can't get the ball at all, and this time Rosie White is dispossessed. New Zealand were the 24th and last team to qualify.
You heard Sebastian talking about Ali Krieger and those 2 years where she was really in the dark, but seeing that there seems to be a revolving door still at that outside back position, and maybe I do have a chance. And this is where I hope every player, young player, trying to get into this bubble or aspiring to play at the highest level, remembers this. With no one watching, with no communication with the national team, with no what seemed to be hope at getting another chance, she trained every single day. Ashlyn Harris, her fiance, would say she would get up and get out there every single day for that moment when she possibly got another look. And she did get that next look and capitalized on it.
Yeah, I remember Ali Krieger walking, making that lonely walk to take the decisive penalty against Brazil in Dresden that day. And she put it away as well. Lloyd again with the layoff to Sam Lewis. Both scurrying away for hoping to win possession. Great bit of play. Typical piece of quick thinking from Tobin Heath. And she sent the defenders out for a cup of coffee there, didn't she?
Nice ball in by Ali Krieger. The double make.
Made wide by Ali Riley. He's gregarious. The idea was good, not quite the execution.
9 goals, by the way, for Tobin Heath in her last 12 games. That includes tonight. This is a player who's been playing very well, very confident. And she just brings a creativity, as we just saw, that you don't see in many women's players at this level.
Here's Riley for New Zealand. Gregorius waiting in the middle. And the ball in was not accurate enough. Ali Riley looking tired at the moment, just jogging back. But there's a ruthlessness here about the United States. It almost looks like no mercy. Pass their way out of trouble. Well, be a chance doing some good work has come on to play on the right side of that defense. 3/4 point of the game, or as near as makes no difference. USA 3-0 up and threatening to add more, I think it's fair to say. There's little Paige Satchel about to come on now. Certainly offers some pace. She was a travelling reserve for the Olympic Games for New Zealand in 2016. Lively character, who used to be her school's cross-country champion. 12th cap for her tonight.
She's going to need that on the flank.
Yeah, they're going to need that energy, aren't they? Riley can't keep it in play. This might be a long last 20 minutes or so here for the New Zealand defence, because they've seen so little of the ball in this second half. Pretty hard when you're just chasing shadows, trying to cover. Done. Nothing doing for Heath that time. Can they get out this time with an accurate ball? The pace being shown by Paige Satchel, as we were promised we'd see that from her anyway. Lewis. Nice ball through the lines. Lloyd doing well. Done. And Alex Morgan had come to the near post and had found about a yard of space as well there and wasn't found. They're having it all their own way now. Heath. Ertz turning and twisting and just too strong. This time Tobin Heath can't quite keep it in. Free spirit both on and off the pitch, Tobin Heath. Even went to France to try her luck for a while, as did Lindsay Hurren. And three more substitutions coming up here. Kristen Press, one of those. This might take a little time to get these substitutions made. Mallory Hugh as well.
If you're New Zealand and you're looking at all these fresh legs coming in, where the U.S.
been given squad number two, Mallory Pugh. That's usually the right back, isn't it?
And here's where the U.S. is so dangerous. The depth they have coming off that bench. You brought in Carly Lloyd, the two-time FIFA World Player of the Year off the bench. You have Kristen Press, I think, would be starting for most national teams in the front line. Mallory Pugh, young star coming in.
And then Alex Morgan's gone off as well. Not by the conventional route, it has to be said. She's walking around on the far side.
Isn't that one of the new laws?
Yes, it is. They're looking to do that. Yeah, you leave.
I love that.
You leave the pitch at the nearest point. Has to stop people using it as a time-wasting gesture. Hang on a minute. Here's Crystal Dunn to play this one in. Carly Lloyd was in there again, hunting for something.
So active in just the 15, 20 minutes that Carly's been in. Getting into positions, sharp on her movement, scoring that third goal to separate, of course, for the United States.
It's almost like she's got a little clock in her head that says, hang on, it's World Cup time again.
Right.
Scored in the quarterfinal, semi-final and final 4 years ago. There's Kristen Press. A very good winner for the US away from home against Spain this year. And Spain, a very good passing side. Watch them if you can. The World Cup. They're now to keep the ball. Just end product they're lacking, but they could be dangerous. Lloyd's waiting in the middle again. Here is Press. It's her first involvement down that left hand side where she likes to operate.
Now you have a whole front line for the United States with fresh legs. Press on the left, Carly Lloyd in the middle, and Mallory Pugh on the right.
ESPN Plus is your home for over 90% of the MLS out-of-market games, including Saturday at 7:30 Eastern, as Philadelphia Union hosts the Seattle Sounders. ESPN Plus also your home for ESPN FC, Serie A, and much more. Start your free trial now by going to ESPN.com and clicking the ESPN Plus tab at the top of the page. And it's Lavelle again. They're trying to get a game of a full 90 minutes into Rose Lavelle, who has had little injury problems along the way. So this might be the day, I think. Got Mexico coming up soon. Sunday week, in fact.
and we'll bring you that game as well on ESPN. It's a lunchtime kickoff, East Coast time, noon, I think. Dunn to cut it back, and somehow the chance goes begging with Mallory Pugh attacking it. Looked like it had to be another one.
Crystal Dunn has put in a shift on that left side tonight, hasn't she? At your left outside back, who's been forward the entire game. And that's one. Mallory Pugh getting caught up there, can't get off the ground. Gets in there just a little too early. Really a chance that should be put away.
Mallory Pugh, who at the moment I think finds herself as the cover for Tobin Heath. Should anything go wrong with her, that's not a bad substitute to have around. Only 21, she's already got 50 plus caps. He's done again. Yeah, you're right, it's a candidate for woman of the match, isn't it? I think from Crystal Dunn. Another contender there, Lavelle, turning into space. She's very quick across the first 5 yards or so, I've noticed. And they have now brought on Hannah Wilkinson. Amid all the flurry of changes, Hannah Wilkinson just back from her cruciate injury. She's only been back doing full training for a week or so. A very important player for New Zealand. Oh, good luck to her. Good luck. What a battle. It's so hard, that, coming back from that injury.
It's been 6 months since surgery, and Tom Sermani said that she has just grinded away and been amazing. And is such an important player to them because she brings this power and pace for them up top that he felt it was worth a roster spot to give her a shot, especially because they have 3 weeks still training.
Rampant now, the U.S., it's just a question of how many. I think if it was boxing, the referee might have stopped it by now.
He did also say, Tom Sermani, he said, you know, we have to be realistic. This is like the preseason for us. And we've got to build in these 3 weeks to what I've been saying to them is like the start of the league, that first World Cup game.
Chance of USA. USA ringing around for what we believe to be a record crowd, just to repeat, for a USA women's standalone friendly match. This stadium held the previous record as well. We don't have the official figure yet, but we think it's over 35,000 anyway. It looks that, look around, not too many spare seats. Ersek and Michaela Moore, who's very composed on the ball, I've noticed back there. Useful player. Rosie White skipping inside. It's a good bit of play by New Zealand. The American born Ali Riley plays it inside. Again, this is good. They've kept the ball here for longer than at any other point in the second half. Probably 15-20 passes, but not that one. Now it's back with the US, and there's more defending yet to do. Now cut out by Katie Bowen back there. Usual, all change in the second half of these friendlies. What are you thinking when you're watching this, Julie? I mean, you've played, you've won the World Cup, you know what it takes. Do you like what you see from this team?
I worry a little bit about them with teams that play in a low block. I feel they get too stagnant, as we saw. This was a case of, I think, fatigue. They did break them down a bit, but a lot of it was the fatigue of the New Zealand team. But if you get a team that's fitter, that's getting into that low block, there needs to be a lot more movement from the U.S. team. We saw this was what ended their Olympics in 2016, a very organized Swedish team, a fit Swedish team.
Who sit back and defend deep.
And it gives them trouble. And that's when you need players like a Rose Lavelle stepping in, a creative type, Lindsay Horan. And those were those two players in particular brought onto this team for that element to be able to break that down. And we saw in the first half against South Africa, we saw in the first 30 against New Zealand here, first 35, a little stagnant. So that is one concern I have. I still am concerned about the goalkeeping position and that in the sense that Alyssa Nair just has no World Cup experience.
Hughes cross. US choosing to use this outfit tonight with the red shirts and virtually invisible blue numbers. So, it's all right if you're about 10 yards from them, but I think anybody in the crowd would be struggling to see them. Long doing well. She's come on to play in the midfield alongside Samantha Mewis there. Krieger started to pass the ball very crisp, but there's now a lot of space out there as the New Zealand players have tired as the game's gone on. By the way, Sell It Out on ESPN continues on Saturday, 11:55 a.m. Eastern on ESPN News. Genoa against Cagliari coming up for you, the match streaming live on the ESPN app as well. Good ball through. Press playing it across. Surely another one here. Yes, there is. And again, it's that lady, Carly Lloyd, arriving. 4-0 to the USA, which in no way inflates their dominance of this game. Five goals in the last three games now for Carly Lloyd.
Started in midfield with an alley-long crunching tackle to get that play started, and credit Press with the ball and Lloyd for making that run. Getting to that near post and getting in front of her defender, knowing just needs to get a touch on the ball. But taking that all the way back to the tackle in midfield from Long. And a great ball in to Press from Pugh.
Up to 110 now. Another star cameo from Carly Lloyd.
And it begs the question, do you give her more minutes?
Well.
Right? And that's something that she's clear.
Lewis deflected, and that's in as well. That's five. The deflection gave the goalkeeper no chance. But Sam Lewis is another player who can't stop scoring at the moment. Two against South Africa, another one here.
How many times have Carolina Courage fans seen her do this from distance? Sam Mewis, we know she can strike that ball, and good things happen when you put things on frame, and especially with a lot of traffic in front of you.
Given away. More with what was a good challenge. She's recovered well. The
USA looking to really rub this in now, late in the game. Just, I think, see from the players' attitude, even though they're against a team who were not expected to really test them in any way, but there's a real edge about them now.
Yeah, and it's an edge, and understandably so. These are players that, especially with those front three who came off the bench, they want more minutes, right? It's not, oh, let's just run this game out, run the clock out, keep the ball. They're pressing defensively. They're wanting to get in the box.
Riley's cross towards Wilkinson, looking for a habitual goal against the U.S. Ali Krieger, who's 34 now, plays for Orlando Pride. She had 90 minutes in the recent game against Belgium, getting back in the swing of things. Lewis again. It was Ali Krieger. It was Carly Lloyd, who's looking for yet another US hat-trick. Chance lays it wide. Cut back by Paige Satchel. Bravely trying to get a goal. I think it's as we thought in the end, the gap was always going to be too big for New Zealand. It's not an easy group they've got either, is it? Netherlands, European champions, Canada, always pretty handy, and then Cameroon.
Very similar, actually, to the World Cup they had in 2015. They lost to Netherlands only 1-0. Drew Canada. Drew China. So close to getting that first World Cup win, which they've talked about. But didn't get through and out of their group in 2015. And I think if you're the United States, you've got one game left. You're thinking, okay, 3-0, 5-0 against teams that you're far superior to. You get a lot of positives out of right there, that player and Carly Lloyd. You build confidence. You build depth.
I think what she's shown in the last couple of matches is it's no kind of sentimental pick to take. She's not along for the ride. She's got a part to play. Even if it's not as a starting place, there might be another one here. Turning on the star now, trying to chip the goalkeeper. I think everybody fancies they can get on the score sheet now. Lewis again from long range. Got a taste for it. Following the conclusion of our match, MLS on ESPN, Carlos Vela and LAFC hosting FC Dallas from the Bank of California Stadium in Los Angeles. The match streaming live on the ESPN app, as well as some star names like Vela on view. That's right after us when we're finished here. And towards Wilkinson, a rare piece of defending to do for Abidal Kempa. What a quiet night back there, in truth, but from the early minutes when Rosie White had a pretty good chance not taken. Here's Lavelle, but a misunderstanding between her and Mallory Pugh. Chance for New Zealand was fouled.
forward. Towards Longo, hasn't been able to get into the game in midfield. It's been a relentless attacking display from the US in the second half. And they're looking for another one. And the effort is blocked. I think that was on its way in. Lloyd could have had a hat-trick.
Such energy, too, to playing in front of crowds like this. In such appreciation as a player, especially as you're heading over to a World Cup. Big round of applause to all the people here in St. Louis for rocking the house tonight.
Yet more defending for the football fans of New Zealand to do. Dunn laying it off to Sam Lewis. Lovely turn from her. Still pumping with adrenaline. Long claiming a penalty that time. Referee's not interested. Crystal Dunn towards the back post.
Why not?
Why not in this situation?
Winding up.
And she's attempted to steal the show, hasn't she? Late on, as Carly Lloyd. The final whistle, 5-0 for the USA. Tobin Heath, Rose Lavelle, Carly Lloyd with two, and Sam Lewis. Unbeaten in 32 consecutive games now at home, the US, since they were beaten by Australia. Tom Somani there. Final thoughts from you. Julie, what do you think?
One game left, 3 weeks, you lock in. It's sharpness, it's confidence, it's continuity. Here they go.
Hats off to the good people of St. Louis tonight who've supported this game very, very well indeed. The US staying on course. 5-0 win for New Zealand as they head for the World Cup. Thanks for joining us tonight. From me, Ian Darke, Julie Foudy, and Sebastian Salazar, we wish you a very good night and we'll see you very soon.